winemaking. So there was this marketing sentence around Barolo. For many reasons. In part, because the king of Italy was making wine in Barolo and not in Barbaresco. In part because Nebbiolo has always been a very challenging variety to grow. And during medieval time, 1500, in difficult moments, somewhere else, included in Barbaresco, sometimes the people pull out Nebbiolo and they planted something that was easier to cultivate, Dolcetto or Barbera. And so Nebbiolo sticked and continued to be produced in Barolo simply because there were noble people like the Falletto family that they were cultivating Nebbiolo for themselves. And so it's true that there has been always more constant production of Nebbiolo in Barolo respect to Barbaresco. So that's the historic reason. Then there is also a technical reason, and that's the reason that in Barolo, because of the soil, it's a more compact soil, you get wines that they have more compact structure, they are more powerful, they have more tannins. And so the wines of Barolo technically have always been considered the most of all, the most powerful, the most tannic, the most ageable. And the wines in Barbaresco were the little brothers of Barolo. So if you were a producer of Barbaresco, you were a producer of a wine that didn't have its own identity. To describe what Barbaresco is, people were always using Barolo as a comparison. How is Barbaresco? Barbaresco is like a Barolo, but less tannic, less structured, less ageable. So it was always less, and how can you describe a wine like this and making it appear as important as Barbaresco, as Barolo is? So that in that sense, we had a big challenge, because people were not expecting that a winery from Barbaresco could become as important, could be considered at the level of a winery in Barolo. And if I look back, my grandfather and my father, they had the same goal. That was the goal of putting Barbaresco on the map. But they really worked in two different methods. They had a different method and same goal. And that's why they always respected each other. They never had a fight. Even when my father did such a crazy thing like planting a vineyard of Cabernet Sauvignon in the center of Barbaresco, and my grandfather obviously didn't agree, and my grandfather never drank Darmaggi. In his opinion, Darmaggi, because he liked to drink only old wines, so for him Darmaggi was never old enough, was not drinking it. So even when my father took a very controversial decision, they never really, I don't remember that they never had a fight, because they were respecting, they knew that the goal was the same. And my grandfather, for me, has been an incredible visionary, meaning that he understood before other people that there was really a potential in Barbaresco. So my grandfather, in the 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, for 40 years, he was basically the only one in the village of Barbaresco that was buying land. And he did something that my father couldn't do as much as he did, because he was there at the right moment and he did it. At the time, the people making wine were negotiants. So the negotiants, they were not investing in land, they were not buying vineyard, they were buying grapes. Even though the negotiants had economic power, they were using their money to buy real estate, not to buy vineyard. It sounds very awkward. And there are negotiants that they started to buy and purchase land only in the late 80s, 90s, very late, when nothing was available anymore. To be a negotiant has always been something quite traditional in Piemonte. So the negotiants, there were some amazing negotiants. But Bruno Giacosa, which is an artisan and is a man that knows grapes and vineyards more than anyone else, he has never been owning vineyard. Until the late, I think the first vineyard that he purchased was the Falletto in the late 80s, very late. And only the most successful company remained, but many disappeared. So you can find wines made by wineries in Barolo and Barbaresco that were negotiants that in the 60s, 50s were there, but they don't exist anymore. So my grandfather was really one of the few that understood that sooner or later something was going to change, and it was important to put your hand and purchase and have as yours the best sites available. And for 40 years he had no competition from the negotiants, that they were not buying land. The few people that were as wise as my grandfather Anyway, they couldn't care less about Barbaresco. So if they were going to buy land, they were buying in Barolo. And so he was the only one that selected land in Barbaresco. And he knew his village by heart very well. And that's why my grandfather never bought land outside from Barbaresco, even though he had chances of buying in Treviso, he had chance of buying even in Barolo, people they came to him to propose in vineyard. But the village that he knew very, very well was Barbaresco, and he bought a vineyard there. He also was there in the right moment, because Italy had, you know, that Italy was managed with the sharecropping system until the 60s. In 1964, the president of Italy declared the sharecropping system illegal. So it means that from 1964, if you had the farmers working your land, you suddenly had to pay them cash or money.
Wages.
Not, yes, wages, not half of the crop. And in reality, the law arrived in 64, but the sharecropping system continued until the late 60s. But so my grandfather was there in the right moment, because in those years, when the sharecropping system finished, suddenly a lot of land that had never been on sale went on sale, because noble people, clergy, or just a wealthy family, that they had major properties. Until that moment, they had was not costing to own land. But suddenly, when you had to start paying people, that's when they said, oh, you know what, then I'm going to sell. And so that's why we could buy from the Church of St. Lawrence this beautiful vineyard, sorry, San Lorenzo, 1958. Mm-hmm. And then my grandfather in 1964 bought Costa Russi and Solitildin. So it was just there at the right moment, and he had already his vision set. He was focused in trying to buy the best site. When my father came in, and now he's 55 years that he's behind Agri Wine, because he started to work almost 55. He started to work in 1961. So when my father started to work with my grandfather in 1961, he was very lucky, more lucky than other producers. And that's because my grandfather had already a name and a reputation, and he was a leader in Italy in the production of considered the high-end wines. The Italian market was very different from today, so my grandfather was selling in Milan and Rome. That was the Italian market. And we didn't have any distributor, agent. It was my grandfather that once a year he was taking the car, he was going down to Rome, he was going to visit the Sabatini restaurant, was making the order for the year. Then for dinner he was going to the Hustler Hotel, having dinner there, making the order for the year, going back home. Mm-hmm. And the same was Milan. Milan, he had one major client, that was the Savini restaurant. It is a restaurant that still exists, that is in the gallery near the Duomo church. And the Savini was the restaurant. There were not many top restaurants in Milan at the time, in the 60s. But that was the place where the best clientele of Milan could go and could drink wine. And we saw that, we found the invoice of my grandfather selling wine to the Savini restaurant. The sommelier fell in love with the Barbaresco 61, and he bought 1,200 cases.
Wow.
Of Barbaresco 61.
1,200.
Yes. So people were buying differently from today. The Savini restaurant had a wine list with 5 wines on the list. One was a Barbaresco Gaia 61. So it was a different market. But I know very well that the price doesn't tell you, it's not that higher is the price, higher is the quality of a product, and we know that. But the market had already a perception of the wines of my grandfather as very reliable and very high in quality, because my grandfather was already selling his Barbaresco to a price that was considered a very important price. But more than the first year that a Barolo wine achieved a price of 1,000 lira. So the first time that a Barolo was sold at 1,000 lira, that was the 1958 Barolo from Renato Ratti. And my grandfather, releasing Barbaresco 1 year before, had already released his Barbaresco 1958 and had a price that was higher than 1,000 lira. So it means that he had already created his his reputation, and people were trusting what their wine were, regardless that they were Barbaresco and not Barolo. Probably also what helped him is the fact that not only was selecting land, but also he decided to select vintages. So he had this idea that he thought that Barbaresco, he had to respect the dignity of his wine. His wine had to come out only when it was really absolutely as he wanted. And so every time there was a bad vintage, he was keeping the bad vintage. He was not coming out with that. And that also helped him in making clear that whatever was available, you could trust that the quality was excellent. When my father came in 1961, had, thanks to all the philosophy of my grandfather, had already a name. Thanks to all the investment that my grandfather had done, my father already owned some of the most beautiful vineyards. So those two things were already quite done. And when my father came in, he started to do something different. That was focusing on the way of managing the vineyard, the way of making the wine, and started a big changement, a big revolution in the making of our wines. The first 10 years, from 1961 to the late 60s, my father was not allowed in the winery, was only allowed in the vineyards. So the first changes that he brought in, he brought them in the vineyards. And, you know, the only way we had to improve our wines was to try a new way of managing the vineyard, of managing the making of the wine better. That's very different, for example, from Tuscany. Tuscany and Piemonte, the renaissance of the Tuscan quality and the renaissance of the Piemonte quality had two very different way of being. Because in Toscana, people were working with Sangiovese, and Sangiovese, they had much more in their mind the concept of blending. So Sangiovese was always blended with something. In Cannaiolo, Colorino, Malvasia, Trebbiano, then the international varieties often was blended. So the Renaissance in Toscana started really with Antinori, that decided to take away Tignanello from the denomination Chianti, because by law, otherwise, he was obliged to blend 40% of white wine. And the white wine was produced such a massive quantity at the time that was like adding water to your red wine. So you can imagine how difficult it was to try to make something complex and serious when you had to add a white wine inside. So when Antinori took out the Tignanello from the denomination Chianti in order to make a wine only with the red grapes, that suddenly, just that alone, was such an improvement in quality from one year to another, that everybody could perceive a major, without other things, just the fact that they took away the white from the red, made their wine growing in quality. And the market immediately perceived that. And suddenly the wine lovers or the wine journalists, they had something to talk about because you had some new category of wine in Toscana. So also there was more interest in Toscan wines. And then people followed. So that's, in my opinion, the reason why abroad, the first region of Italy that became well known for quality has been Toscana. And Piemonte, the only way you could improve your wine was to find a new way of managing your vineyard, and everyone really worked in improving quality, but it took a longer time before people could perceive that. It took years and years before you suddenly could feel in the wines that the quality was changing. So for the first 10 years, my father focused with one goal. His goal was to reduce quantity. He had to reduce quantity in order to have an even production, more ripe, less uneven. And so how we could reduce quantity? First of all, higher density of plants per hectare. That's why he started to plant vineyard vertical like a big part of Sori San Lorenzo.
Is actually the slope, which is the opposite to what everyone else
sees. This is the vineyard of Sori San Lorenzo, starting from the house. So starting from here, you have Sori San Lorenzo. The very, very old part of Sori San Lorenzo is this one, and still is horizontally planted. But the other part has been replanted in the years vertically. You plant horizontally, you need to leave 2.50 meters, 2.80 meters. You need to leave a lot of space, because it's steep, and if you walk and immediately behind you, you have another row, you can damage it, maybe the soil moves, so you need to have more game. So that's why traditionally the plantation in Piemonte have been 4,500, 4,800 plants per hectare. Planting vertically, you can go up to 6,000 plants per hectare. And so every plant understands that only has this much soil available, is going to explore it with a lot of baby roots, is going to produce less. It's a way to have a lower quantity. Then short pruning, green harvest, two techniques that were coming from France, but that my father introduced in the early 60s, and even in France they were not so widely used as much as he started to do. 1961 started with short pruning. I think that in the early 70s systematically he started to work with green harvest. And so then of course started to work also on clonal selections, on better grafting, and some new plantation were due to that as well. So suddenly the grapes started completely to change. So from different grapes, then you bring them in inside the winery and other changes in the winery started. So when you have grapes that are more ripe, they release from the skin and the taste and the structure in an easier way without having to push down all the skin and keep them. This is a very traditional way of working with Sangiovese, just to put something, maybe a wood on top and push down the skin so that they remain there soaked in juice for a long, long time. But he started to do less and less of that because they were easily giving more to the juice. And then started to experiment with different wood. Started with barrique, went in France because he studied in Montpellier. So he went in France, he got some barrique. His idea was that a tannic wine like Nebbiolo was not going to go well with barrique because barrique can release more bitter tannins and the wine is bitter already. So he started the experiments with Barbera, because Barbera has no tannin, so he felt that was working better with that. And then he moved it on Nebbiolo. And there is a... And so everything started to change. There has never been only a use of barrique. There has never been a roto macerator used. But there have been a lot of things that have been introduced in the making of wine that then other people took. And that started to change the way of making wines all over Piemonte. So I think that... changes are incredibly important because if you do things always in the same way, you are stuck there. And if you look at the quality that we have today in Piemonte, in my opinion, there is no other region in Italy with such a high average quality, as much as you have in the area of Barolo and Barbaresco. There have been extremes, because that's always how things goes. So from an extreme traditional old way of making wines and maybe habits that people had and that they were a bit chained by them, suddenly people started to work in a more modern way. So in the past the problem was the main problem was that grapes they were never constantly perfectly ripe, so the wines they always had tannins that they were becoming green, a bitter tannins. There was not an expression of fruit because the grapes were not fully ripe. The aging in wood was so long that after a while the wines had a volatile acidity, or maybe they were already slightly oxidized. So to all these extremes of bad winemaking arrived as a reaction another extreme that also led to some bad winemaking. So you moved from grapes that were not perfectly ripe to suddenly in the 80s, 90s, you started to find wines made with grapes too ripe. If before people were using casks that were too old, suddenly you moved to another extreme, wood that was much too new. And then in between arrived also global warming that didn't help, the fact that everyone was trying to make wine more concentrated, more fruity, because then became an added thing that didn't help at all. But these two extreme groups, that the extremes are never balanced, so the extreme traditionalist and the extreme modernist that started to fight one with the other, instead of remaining two separate fighters, in reality, little by little, they merged. And the only good thing that, one of the greatest things that modernity brought has been clarity to the wines. wines that they can show much more where they come from because they don't have interference of old wood that as there was before. And that's why today there is such a high quality in Piemonte, because traditionalists learn from modernists, modernists learn from traditionalists. Today the style is much more equilibrated. And you come to Piemonte and no one talks anymore about style. There is much less talking because it doesn't make anymore, it's not so evident who is traditionalist, who is modernist. Everyone is making a style that is more similar. And now there is a new topic that everybody talks about. So that is sold. Now mm-hmm. you go forward and you start talking about sustainable, natural, and another step. And so all the new fashion that comes of natural wines, that's another example of something that leads to extremes. And there are some extreme examples of wines that maybe have some fault. But anyway, mm-hmm. it's something else, the new philosophy that is pushing the boundaries. And so it's obliging everyone to face that there is a new way of making wine, and then maybe there is something good there, and you can be with or against, but it's moving forward. And so it's always like that, I think, that